and get ready to have a discussion about how to use your creative talents to sell. Now it's time for a message from today's sponsor.
Wow, I can sell my B2B SaaS product anywhere in the world. Maybe I should start selling in Europe.
Not so fast, Jimmy. Have you ever run a European marketing campaign before?
No? Gosh, I guess not.
Can you write fluently in multiple languages?
No, just the one.
Do you know anything about regulations in Europe?
Maybe I could just have my team bullshit their way through it.
Sound familiar? Hello, my name is Dr. Funkenstein. You know, when I need medical advice, I ask a doctor, but when I need SEO advice, I ask Flying Cat Marketing. Flying Cat is the world leader in customized local SEO and marketing campaigns. They have a team of native language marketing experts spanning across 15 different countries to build fully local campaigns to create and capture demand and increase organic search conversions for your business.
Wow, Dr. Funkenstein. I reached out to Flying Cat just like you said, and they were super easy to work with. How can I ever repay you?
Don't worry, Jimmy. I'll be reaching out to you for a personal favor very soon.
What?
Don't ask your doctor if SEO is right for your business. Get started with your free consultation at flyingcatmarketing.com.
Live from Chicago, it's Chris Sells His Soul. I'm your host, Chris Bogue, and this is my show where I have conversations with cool people who will help you work more creatively. Today, my guest is Dan Goodman. Dan, please say hello and let my audience know where they can find you.
Hello, everyone. I'm Dan Goodman. You can find me on LinkedIn. You can. We have a webpage under construction that will be launching soon, dangoodmanea.com. Also, Dan Goodman Employment Advisory on LinkedIn. I am a passionate advocate for folks, employees in all settings. I've been doing this for a long time, and I love helping people be informed to stand up to wrongdoing, make informed decisions, and not be taken advantage of.
Excellent. Yes. Today's episode is called Don't Get Screwed. So we're going to be talking a lot about getting hired, getting fired, where people make mistakes, where employees are afraid to stand up for themselves, and what you can do to empower yourself at home. So some important notes. Today's episode is brought to you by Flying Cat. They're the premier agency for SEO, and we're going to be hearing from them later on in the show. But you also might be wondering who I am. So my name is Chris Bogue. This is my show. I am an entrepreneur and coach and sketch comedian living in Chicago. I coach people to make mercifully short video content that drives revenue, and you can find me on LinkedIn. Just go search for Chris Bogue and you can ring my bell. I post new comedy all the time, but it is almost always focused on how you can go out there, how you can be your best self on camera, and how you can show up in a way that is short, fun, approachable, and gonna make money for your business. So Dan and I are about to get in here. We're going to jump in and start on our first topic. But before we do that, we want to hear from you. So I see some people here in the audience. We've got Lauren, we've got Patty. Brad is here saying, I need to get me one of those instruments. Yeah, you do. People don't realize I play every theme song to every episode myself. That's called an electric wind instrument. That is my weird synthesizer that I use to play the theme music. So Dan and I are going to be talking here. I've got a ton of questions I want to ask him, but we want to hear from you. So, today's episode has attracted more anonymous questions than usual. I had a lot of people reach out asking questions about what they can do to protect themselves, what they can do to help protect their employment and not get screwed over. So we're going to be answering their questions. Go ahead. If you have a question you want to ask, you can drop them in the comments. You can also just let us know where you're watching from. Join in. You can send me questions privately if you don't want me to read your name live on air. But yeah, interact, take part in the show. We're going to be answering your questions the whole time. We got Michael here, who's a Boston fan. So Dan probably already is a fan of his. And yeah, this is an interactive show. So please comment, ask questions, engage throughout. And without further ado, let's get started. So, Dan, this is actually an episode that has caused some controversy. I've actually seen some people, for every 10 people that have reached out being like, oh my gosh, this is such a great topic. There's so much chaos happening at my job right now. I have so many questions about pips and severance and hiring and firing. I get somebody who's like, look at all these crybabies, you know, whining about how unfair life is. So I have thoughts on that. But why don't we just start? Why don't you just tell the audience what it is that you do and why do you do it?
I'm an employee advocate. I help employees stand up to their employer. I help them resolve disputes with their employer across 8 different practice areas. If you've got any questions or issues around an employment agreement, restrictive clauses, severance, PIPs, stock equity grants, comp plans, wage theft or commission disputes, or general coaching guidance and advice. I have, throughout my entire life, have always been someone who challenged authority, questioned things, did not just blindly trust things, wanted to know why things happened, not just be told that they were. And I kind of came out of the womb that way. My parents didn't love it so much, but it's really helped me a lot throughout my life and career to make sure that I'm not being taken advantage of. It's extremely empowering to stand up to wrongdoing, call it out, and be able to put it behind you. If you don't, it will linger on for years or decades, and you won't be able to go past it.
Yeah, I will say this too. So, you know, and, you know, we've been talking about this like on LinkedIn for the past week or so, but you can still get fired even though you're a high performer. I know people who have consistently smashed their quotas, like literally never missed a revenue target. And due to, you know, mistakes their boss made, all of a sudden they're the ones being pushed out the door. And, you know, corporate America, HR departments, they've got this way of making it seem like they're doing you a favor. You know, Dan, have you ever watched the show Fargo?
Yes, I love Fargo.
Yeah, there's a great line, I believe it's in season 2, where they go to one character, he goes, I like you. And the other guy goes, well, I'm very polite. And he goes, oh, you're not polite. But it's the way you're not polite. It's like you're doing me a favor. And that's what HR does. That's what these agreements do. They act like they're doing you a favor, and they don't want you to ask questions, but you can always ask questions. And today we're going to be talking about just some of the most common situations that people find themselves in, some of the most common mistakes people make when they're getting hired or fired, and what are some simple things we can do to make sure that we're not being taken advantage of in our jobs. So, let's start with, what background and training do you have, Dan?
I mean, the way this business started is really, it's quite a story, quite a backstory, I'll tell you. Please. You know, I'm new to LinkedIn. I've never used social media in my life. I've been at it for about 1.5 years. And I started this company called True Commish, which is a commission audit service to help salespeople verify commission pay and identify and quantify pay errors. We're bootstrapping the business as a way to bring awareness around it. I was told I have to start posting on LinkedIn. It took me a while to figure out how to do it. I put some posts out there. The third post I ever did in my life got 128,000 impressions, about a 30K commission loss. Fast forward 3 or 4 months, I'm just starting to dabble with it a little bit. I put a post out about severance and it got 400,000 impressions. And within a week, I had 20 people pleading with me to review their severance agreement and help them. So I went off and did that for about 3, 4, 5, 6 months, having hundreds and hundreds of free calls with folks. I got on a call with a guy from Israel who was asking me some business questions, answered his questions. He said, Dan, how much do I owe you? I said, well, I don't really charge for this. He called me some name in Hebrew. I had no idea what it said. I said, what did you say? What does it mean? He says, you're a sucker. I said, what do you mean I'm a sucker? He says, you give great advice for free and don't charge anybody. That's my definition of a sucker. So we went round and round with that a few times. And then he said, well, you know, I need to pay you something. So I said, all right, let me get my wife's Venmo because I don't even have that stuff. And he said, well, how much should I pay? I said, whatever you want. He sent me $300. And from that point on, I started charging people for my time. 625 clients later, less than 13 months forward. And that's kind of how this business started off. And I remember the day, I remember I spoke to a CRO at 7 o'clock on a Friday night. And this guy was one of the most impressive people that I spoke to. He had taken a company that he started with about $100,000 in revenue and grew it to $200 million in revenue. They went public and he was terminated at almost 60 years old with probably $50 million in equity that he was going to lose out on. He knew so little about the process. He was so blindsided. He was so traumatized by it all that that moment right there, even though I had been consulting for about 3 months, that moment right there, I went and spent 14 consecutive hours and wrote 30 pages of a framework of this practice, of each of the practice areas, the whole purpose behind it. And that was really the start of it right there.
Amazing. I see a note from Brad here. Brad says, hey, be nice to HR, which let's be charitable here. I'm going to be charitable for anybody out there. I will say, as a guy who has worked in a lot of sales positions, those compensation plans are always changing. And sometimes, even if your boss is 100% on your side, they still make mistakes. Things don't get accounted for. Commission plans, especially if you're in sales, can be very complicated. There's all sorts of multipliers. There's all sorts of different levels. There's all sorts of thing one causes thing two to happen to thing three. And I have been in situations where, like, yeah, I need to sit down and spend 30 minutes going through and tracking all my own results. And I go to my boss and I'm like, hey, you guys are $3,000 short. And they're like, oh, okay, that's fine. And then it gets, you know, settled and I get paid out. So I want to just let everybody know here, like, sometimes this is not even done maliciously. Like, I'm saying, as a guy who consults with companies, who I get brought in, I'm training companies, I'm auditing their sales and marketing processes. Even the good ones, the ones that are getting the funded, they're getting funded, they have a higher percentage of reps making quota than other ones, they're a mess. They're a mess behind the scenes. They've got everything written in PowerPoint slides and Google Sheets. They're trying to do the right thing, and they're still going to make mistakes, right? So knowing that, you could imagine if you have an employer that's less than 100% honest, or, you know, they're trying to screw you over, like, yeah, they're going to make it even harder to know what's going on. So we've got a user who reached out here, and they said, how did I even know if I had a case? You know, some of the biggest problems happen because we don't know what we don't know. So Dan, do you run into people who have a case and they don't even know it?
Most of the time. I mean, employers prey off of this. I mean, most employees are, and most individuals avoid confrontation. They've been raised that way throughout their life, to be blindly trusting and not to question things, to have blind trust for religious figures, you know, doctors, lawyers, employers. And, you know, there are good and bad in every walk of life. And if you just sit there and blindly trust, then you're setting yourself up for failure. You need to question things, you know. I mean, employers prey on that. If, you know, I did a survey, you know, about 6 months ago, and it basically said most people don't even know that you can negotiate severance. The ones that do know that you can don't know how to do it, are too traumatized to, or want to move forward and don't want to deal with the negativity. So if 60, 70% of the people either don't know you can, or don't know how to, do you think the employer is going to offer you the best severance? I mean, as far as whether you have a case or not, I mean, we're talking, that's a kind of a vague question, and we can ask Vague Man about that later on. But I mean, as far as how that goes, I mean, you know, everything is different, whether it's a restrictive clause and trying to prevent you to go to another employer, whether it's games around the comp plan. You know, they like to put on this farce that, you know, things are legal binding contracts, but in reality, they're not. They just want you to abide by them while they don't. An employment agreement is one of the best examples of that. Almost every employment agreement you'll see will say in small letters at the end of it that the employer can change the terms anytime they want, with or without notice, without reason. So if it's a binding contract, one party can't change the terms on the other without their agreement and to be compensated for the change. So this is the farce that they want to put on you. It's the same thing with non-competes. It's the same thing with PIPs. You know, they want you to think a certain way so that you will not take action that you may be entitled to do in fear of being bullied or intimidated from doing that. So if you question things, challenge things, bring them to a head, oftentimes you'll come out on top. It's the same thing with non-competes. I mean, it's the employer's job to have that enforced. They have to write it in such a specific way that it's not too vague and it's not too overly cumbersome. And it sort of has to be just right in the middle. And they purposely write them to be overly vague and cumbersome so that the employee will not take action when it likely wouldn't be enforceable in the first place.
Yeah. And, you know, one thing, if like, we've got a lot of people who are fans of this show who are not salespeople. But one thing you learn in sales is like when you are applying for a job is like, I have talked to sales leaders, sales hiring managers, where if you don't negotiate for more pay, you don't get the job. Like they literally say, if you're the type of, if you just look at the job listing and you accept the pay there and you don't try to negotiate for more pay, they think this person's going to leave money on the table.
It's a really great point, Chris. It's a great point. I tell this all the time to people. I tell them to plan their exit before they arrive. I tell them to wait until they get the offer in writing and then ask all the questions that you didn't have the guts to do without the offer. You want to create a relationship that's viewed on equal footing, or else you're setting yourself up to be taken advantage of. So, you know, go and ask all those questions. Go and negotiate those restrictive clauses. Go and negotiate that comp plan. Frankly, you'll be respected for it by doing so. Most people think like, oh, I can't say that. They'll pull the job. They'll think I'm a whiner or a complainer. No, they'll have a certain level of respect and look at you through a lens of more of an equal footing and not someone who can be taken advantage of or manipulated.
Give me an example of what's a question that people are typically too afraid to ask during the hiring process that they really should ask.
And I'll give you more of a general one. What I like to do is, a lot of people have been burnt throughout their career, right? And you want to make sure you're going to a good situation that you're not going to get burnt before. So what I love to do is turn around to the CEO or the hiring manager and ask them a hypothetical question that may not actually be hypothetical to you, but something you've experienced before in the past. One that relies on them to indicate sort of what their morals and values and moral compass is all about. So, you know, you ask a hypothetical question, say, hey, how would you respond to the situation? If you're in sales, it could be about territory management. It could be things such as windfall clauses, or, you know, things like that. You know, when you've been screwed in the past as a sales guy around compensation, about, you know, been mistreated or in an unequal way, ask the hiring manager or the CEO, how would they deal with this in this type of a situation? Have they ever invoked windfall clauses? Did they do change comp plans mid-year? Have they done retroactive comp plan changes in the past? You know, all those things that, you know, you have heard stories of people getting screwed out over in the past. Ask them hypothetically how they would deal with the scenario.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. And it's actually, so the second half of the show, we're going to be getting into some actionable things the audience can be doing. But I actually had an anonymous questioner reach out. And, you know, maybe this will have to be something we think about for the second half of the show here. But they had asked me, like, what do you do with, like, how do you think about asking questions as an employee when every question you asked could potentially be used against you at some point? And I've seen this before where it's like, management will tell you, we want people to come up to us. We want you to ask too many questions. You know, if you're struggling with something, we want your manager to come in, ask for help. So you ask those questions, you ask for the help, you say, hey, I'm struggling with X and Y and Z. But the second they want you out of the door, they go, well, you said yourself, you do have trouble with this and you do have trouble with that. So how do you know what questions to ask and what questions are going to turn around and get used as a weapon against you if the tables turn?
That's a great question. I'll answer that. And I'll say one more thing. If they ever ask you if you're happy here, it's a setup. Okay. Mm-hmm. They don't want to employ unhappy employees. You are very happy here. You want to stay here for a long time. And when you're asked a question like that, it's asked in a way to set you up. I've seen this. I mean, I did a post about this. It got like 300,000 impressions about 4 months ago. I got literally almost 100 different DMs saying, I've literally gone through this exact same thing that you're describing. It's a complete setup. You know, so that you want to be careful for. As far as questions, I mean, human resources is not there to resolve your issues. They are there to protect the employer in every instance. You must remember that. There are plenty of good people who work in human resources, okay? Absolutely. And they're internally torn in a massive way. Do they stand up to do the right thing and risk their job? Or do they just, you know, placate the situation and do nothing for the employee? They are there solely for the employer in every situation. If you go to them about an issue, there's a good chance that you'll be not working there in 3 months. There's a good chance that the issue will be deflected back on you, that you're the problem. So, you know, I go to human resources when I want to have my situation documented, that I can leverage that information in the future. As far as going to human resources and asking them to resolve an issue between a manager and you, not a good situation. You're very rarely will that be resolved in a way that you expect it to. So that's my thoughts there. You know, when you're complaining about, you know, training, enablement, onboarding, territory management, you know, that kind of thing, they just want to run the business. And if you can't work within their realm, then you're a problem. And more often than not, you'll get let go early. So if you look at it through that lens and you're strategic and you don't look at them as someone who's out to help you, because they're not, they're out to make sure the ship runs smoothly. And if you're going to cause any waves, you're gone.
Yeah. Your HR person might be very nice, but their job description is not about being nice to you, you know, and they might screw you over with a compassionate tone of voice and a friendly pat on the shoulder because they're a nice person, but this really isn't about being nice. This is about protecting yourself and your financial livelihood.
And something I want to add to that, they are not your priest or rabbi, and they're not your attorney. They have no obligation to keep anything confidential, even regarding your own private health information. So do not think for a minute that you're having a confidential conversation that you're confiding in human resources to bounce an issue off of. They, before you even close the door behind them, they're already calling leadership and telling them what you asked them not to.
Yeah. I think that's actually an excellent segue to our next segment, Gimme Gimme. Dan, are you ready to do Gimme Gimme?
I am ready. Let's do it.
All right. So there is a nasty misconception that has been going around on LinkedIn, and we like to address it during the show. So some people out there think that the purpose of LinkedIn is to make friends or to selflessly give away value and ask for nothing in return. But we know that's not true. Yeah. Actually, LinkedIn is the only social network that was created exclusively for people to make money. That's right, folks. It was designed so people could upload their resumes so they could get higher paying job opportunities, better employees, new contract opportunities. So every once in a while, I like to get into character, and my guests and I like to ask my audience for exactly what we want from them. So Dan, you ready to do this?
I am. Let's do it.
Let's do it. Hello! Welcome to another episode of Gimme Gimme, the part of the show where I ask you for money. Today's episode is brought to you by the good people at Flying Cat. That's right. Flying Cat is an international SEO and content agency that helps you execute organic growth programs. So Flying Cat is remote. They're a remote company with a team of 90% women from 15 different countries. You know, women? You ever heard of that? The people that are responsible for 80% of all purchasing decisions? Maybe it would be a good idea to have them involved in your SEO strategy, especially if you want to make money by expanding into European markets and you don't know anything about Europe, which is most of the American companies that I talk to. So Flying Cat has a demand gen and demand capture full funnel approach. They help you reduce customer acquisition costs through organic marketing. Their team of native language strategists and content creators from all over the world help you create smart, effective campaigns regardless of where you do business. So their goal is to help companies increase organic search conversions rates by 50% in 90 days and add $10 million in organic opportunities within 12 months. They are super cool. You can tell that because they are sponsoring today's show. If you need an SEO strategy, get out there and contact Flying Cat. You can find them. Go ahead, scan the QR code on the screen right now. I will give you a moment to do that. And Dan, why don't we take this opportunity? You've got my audience here. This is LinkedIn, so we know everybody at home has money. Why don't you tell my audience what you want from them?
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, boss. I just want one thing. Having watched for decades and decades, employees just sitting there and taking it and getting screwed and carrying that regret with them for years and decades and having it impact their personal lives and professional trajectory, I have one ask of everyone. The next time you get screwed over, stand up to it. Stand up to it for yourself, your family, your trajectory, and even more importantly, the next person that comes behind you or after you. That's the reason why this situation exists today. That's why everyone is getting screwed left and right on a daily basis, is that we collectively allow it to happen because we do nothing about it. If we stand up for it one person at a time, you have a community behind you that will support you. I will support you. I will call it out. I will provide guidance. But we need collectively to put an end to what is happening now. It's wrong in every way. And the next person that does it will be the start of it, and we will make it happen.
Yeah, don't sign anything unless you talk to Dan. Are you crazy? They pull you into an emergency Zoom meeting and put a document in front of you and tell you to sign it? Tell them you need a minute. All right? You want to go punch a pillow? You want to go do something to let off steam? Go do that and then scan that QR code and talk to Dan Goodman. All right? Otherwise, you're going to be leaving potentially tens of thousands of dollars on the table because you didn't want to ask an awkward question. No, we're not going to hear about it. He did not have over 600 clients in 1 year because he's out there talking about having a positive mindset. All right? He knows the questions you should be asking, even if you don't. All right? So go out there, have a good long cry, just like I do. Then call Dan and go out there and fight back.
Yes.
By the way, after you're done doing that, give me a call. Right? So if you're out there, if you want to be getting on video, if you have a team that you're managing and they are miserable and sullen and depressed and afraid to pick up the phone, afraid to go out there and make sales, or maybe you don't know what to do because you've got to manage your team and you don't know anything to do other than getting your team liquored up, I've got options for you. I can have you going out there having fun. I teach workshops. I do training and consulting for how to get the best version of you out there on video. I do video prospecting. I do video content creation. And I also do improvisational storytelling. So drop me a line. I've got all sorts of packages. I will come in there. And all my training is designed to help create a friendly, non-judgmental environment. Do not be alarmed by the way that I am screaming at you right now. I just do this because it's funny. Call Chris Bogue. I'm going to come in there and help you look awesome and make money on video. So you can scan that QR code. I also have a course. We're going to be watching an advertisement for that in just a moment. But before we do, Dan, do you have anything else you want to ask my audience for today?
I don't have anything else. Just stand up, don't have regret, and take care for the next guy, not just yourself.
Yeah, you are not alone here, even though they make you feel like you're alone. Reach out to Dan. He will help you out. This has been Gimme Gimme. Iggy, roll the tape.
Hello, is this Mr. Sherbert?
It sure is. What can I help you with, brother?
Hello, you were not expecting this call. Do you have 17 seconds to learn about mercifully short-
Is this a cold call?
I don't know.
F*** you. Never call this number again.
Oh no! Another unsuccessful cold call. You probably don't have time to fuck off.
I got a quota to hit.
Are you spending hours every week cold calling and cold emailing but not seeing results?
There's gotta be a better way.
Introducing the complete guide to selling on video. Whether you're new to sales or a President's Club member, this fast and fun course will teach you to efficiently create short, customized videos that get results. The complete guide to selling on video is not sold in stores. Visit chrisbogue.io and use promo code GIMMEGIMME to take $50 off while supplies last. Don't delay. Get noticed today.
And we're back. If you are just joining me, I have Dan Goodman here. And we are talking about how you can avoid getting screwed during the hiring and firing process. So we spent the first half of the episode talking a little bit about Dan, how Dan got here, what kind of work he's doing. Now we're going to pivot over to you, the viewer at home. So a lot of people here are watching this. I see some great questions here from people who have had issues, maybe themselves, maybe with people in their life who are going through a difficult situation at work. So we're going to try to make the second half of this show as actionable as possible. So go ahead, comment if you have questions or comments you want Dan and I to address, or if you're not comfortable sharing your name, you can always send me a direct message. I will bring your question up. I will not mention you. We will keep your privacy private because, yeah, these can be very difficult things going through here. So I guess we can start with this question. So we've got a user here who says, I have a friend. It isn't them, but it's their daughter who had a baby on FMLA. I'm not familiar with that term.
Family Medical Leave Act.
Okay. And then extended due to an injury, she came back after that leave and was terminated. She hadn't worked for the company long, did not get a severance. The question is, does she have any way to get compensated?
So companies have no legal obligation to offer any severance. They don't do it because they're nice or they feel bad or they're kind people. They do it for their own selfish reasons solely. And that's for you to sign a release of liability, to promise to never sue, release them of all claims, past, present, future, known and unknown. That's the sole reason. So if you can present to the employer why it's in their best interest to offer you a fair and equitable separation, they'll do it. They try to minimize their costs. Most people don't realize that you can negotiate one or why they even offer one. So when you can show the employer that you understand how the game is played, oftentimes they will significantly improve your severance offer. Of the folks that I've worked with personally, the last 120 clients that we've worked with, we've increased the severance offer by 134%. An average increase of $32,000 per severance, and the average success rate's been about 70%. Collectively, since May or June, I've helped employees increase their severance by more than $2.6 million.
It's mind-blowing.
It is, and if you don't ask, I can guarantee it won't increase.
Yeah, let's talk a little bit more. So I'm interested. It sounds like here there's an issue of knowing who actually has the power in this kind of a situation, right? So, when you're in the hot seat, when you're an employee, maybe you got a family, maybe you got medical bills, you got a mortgage, things like that. The thought of losing your job is terrifying. And someone presents you a severance offer, the easiest impulse is to just take whatever you can get. Right. So if this is all just an agreement where they can do anything at any time and they're not legally bound to give you a severance, like why would they ever decide to give you more? Like I just asked my own question. I'll let you.
So, I mean, the way it works with my process and the success that we've had is that I use three pillars to put together a response to the severance offer. Whether it's based on legality, and I'm not an attorney, but there's very clear situations where they've broken the law, whether it's age discrimination, whether it's accommodations for disabilities. I mean, there's dozens and dozens of reasons where they break the law. Now, everyone is considered an employee at will in every state in the union, except for Montana. I don't know why, but every state in the union, except for Montana, is an employee at will. So, there's a farce around that, though. In reality, it's the employee who is the employee at will, not the employer. The employee can truly come and go anytime they want with or without any reason or communication. That is not the case with the employer. If you're an employee at will and you're not any protected class, it does apply. But there are many, many, many instances where an employer cannot just freely terminate an employee and say, too bad, you know, what are you going to do about it? So, you know, you need to be able to understand your rights, you know, stand up to things, question things, and not let these employers just steamroll all over you. And just take it and believe what they're saying and do it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think this is something that people should know is that companies try to make everything look very official. You know, it's not though, including your compensation, including your terms of employment, commission plans. They just made all that stuff up. And the second it becomes too generous and the employees are getting too much and they feel they're not getting enough, they're just going to switch that on a dime.
Yep.
And a mistake that I see salespeople fall into is they think because they are a reliable revenue earner that they're protected. And sometimes that's not the only thing the company cares about. So I can think of specific issues of people I know. But Dan, have you ever run into a situation where somebody is, by all accounts, making money for the company, yet they still get laid off? Why does that happen?
So there's a lot of reasons for it. You could be a rock star rep, gone on President's Club for 8 years in a row. A new CRO comes in, or VP of sales. They look at you as a threat, someone who's not just going to roll over and do whatever they're told, and they want to make an example out of you to scare everybody else. That would be one scenario. I mean, there's so many when leadership needs to make their number. And they've got a rep who's about to get $100,000 commission on a $1 million deal. They can terminate that rep. They can take it back through a windfall clause. All of a sudden, they're taking that $100,000, throwing it right to the bottom line. Now the managers are making their quarterly performance numbers to make their bonuses at the expense of the reps who work their ass off to earn that money. If you question and complain about the theft, you'll be terminated for not being aligned with them within a few months. It literally plays itself out over and over and over again. If you're a top rep, I can steal from just that one rep and make my number rather than screwing three other reps. That's literally, it's sad to say, I see it so much over and over and over again. In some ways, you're better off shooting for the middle. And that is never how I have been wired ever. It's sad to say. If you're a low performer, you'll get asked for not doing anything. If you're a top performer, you'll get asked to steal your commission. If you're right in the middle, no one's even noticing you. It's sad to say, I don't agree with it at all. It goes against everything that I've got to believe in. But what I've been seeing for the last year and a half doing this, it's disgusting. And sadly, it's what it is.
Yeah. Or here's another one that I know is way more common than people realize, is sexual harassment.
I've had many of those.
I have known women who are better than me at sales. Women who have never met a quota that they didn't crush. You know, very, very, very strong team members, very strong revenue earners, never complain, never bring up an issue. And then their boss sexually harasses them. And that's a problem because maybe they were a top revenue earner, but their boss was an even bigger revenue earner. And they've decided they're friends with that boss, or they want to keep the boss on the team, or they like the boss as a manager. So now they're just going to quietly push you out the door. Maybe they're going to push you to a different department. Or again, I bring up the quote from Fargo because oftentimes they'll do this as a favor. Like, hey, we're looking out for you. We're going to help you find a different job, you know? And really what happened is you should be firing the manager, you know? But again, you're thrown into this weird situation where you're being disrespected. You're being treated badly. And you think that, you know, crushing those quotas, making that money for the company is going to save you. But it's not about that, you know.
It's about favoritism, nepotism, protecting people. I mean, Chris, I literally speak to at least two or three people every single day with the exact same story that you've described. That they've been here for a year, 2 years, 3 years. They're a top performer. A new boss comes in. They're bringing in their own people. They're pushing these top performers out. And it's just based on all this lies and deceit. I mean, I've seen scenarios where managers have gone in and changed the CRM to make the rep look bad, to then use that information as justification to terminate them. I've got dozens of stories of underhanded behavior that can be documented to show. And in several instances, we've actually gone and around HR, around everybody, and gone right to the CEO and brought this to their attention, who was not in the loop with some of this stuff. And when they found out about it, heads rolled. I mean, you talk about sexual harassment. Here's a great story. I'm working with a client right now, actually. All right. The guy in his, you know, maybe mid 40s, he was dating a coworker, a fellow sales rep. Okay. She was having an affair with their dual manager who was married.
Ooh.
The dual manager fired my client because he was the boyfriend of the guy he was having an affair with. Management found out about him. The manager got fired now too. And she's still working there. Okay, so two guys are out, and the manager should have been gone a long time ago. And this behavior goes on all the time. You know, sales kickoffs, you know, president's clubs, they're encouraging people to be doing shots with and married folks dancing on dance floors. There's videotapes I've seen from clients, all types of horrendous behavior that, you know, immature leadership enables and allows to have happen. It creates a massive liability for the organization. But the problem is if the employees don't stand up to it, don't call it out, don't let them know that I'm going to pursue this, then they just walk away the victim every time.
Could that be like a double-edged thing though, where like, I don't know, again, you've seen more than I have, you know, but let's say you are a good employee. You've done your job very well. But yeah, maybe you were encouraged to do some shots at the, you know, President's Club trip to Costa Rica. And maybe you got a little too drunk, or maybe you embarrassed yourself or something like that. Do you ever see that used against people to try to terminate them or to try to deny them of wages that they earned and people going along with it because they're
you know what I see is that at the time they brush it under the rug, and then 3, 4, 5 months later when they want to get rid of them, what didn't matter 3 or 4 months earlier all of a sudden is a reason for termination. Seen that happen all the time. I've seen issues where complaints were made about someone 12 months earlier. It was resolved. Nothing came out of it. And they're using that as a rationale for termination. Of course, that with the old famous performance issue for the guy at 120% of goal and is supposed to go on President's Club in 3 weeks.
Yeah, we got a great comment here from Michael who says, you know, I had a comp plan at a bank, changed 6 times in the first year of the employment. The first change happened within 1 month. My hire. Yeah, that's very common. They're always going to be changing those comp plans. They change those comp plans like 10 times a year. But yeah, they don't expect employees to.
So one thing I did want to mention, a little piece of advice I want to provide to the audience. My recommendation is under no scenario should you ever resign your job. I mean, obviously, if you have a better job to go to and you're going to go off to another opportunity, of course, resign. But if you're unhappy, if you're not performing well, if you're having mental health issues, if they're pressuring you to leave, by you resigning, you're actually doing what they want you to do. They have been traumatizing you. They have been treating you harshly and poorly and impacting your mental health that you're bringing that home with you every day. Go on an FMLA leave. That's what they're there for. When you go on that leave, the employer is legally required to hold your job and pay your benefits during that time. If you don't go on an FMLA leave and they just say, oh, no, hey, Chris, don't worry about it. We got you covered. Go and take some time off. You're fine. Well, you know what? I've heard that. And they got terminated and they didn't have FMLA in place or any protections for their job. So don't be trusting. Fill out the paperwork, take the extra step, you know, protect yourself. And if work is so bad that you need to resign, go on short-term disability. Go take an FMLA leave if you haven't been, if you're eligible for it. But don't do what they want. Take that time, find another job, get yourself in a good place mentally and physically, and protect yourself. The job isn't worth it. And I'm not saying to stay stuck in a horrible situation and hurt yourself, but don't just resign. That's what they want. Use the resources available to you and the benefits available to you to set yourself up to not have financial and professional failure.
Here's a question I received anonymously. How often are PIPs genuinely used as a tool for improvement versus a legal safeguard for companies planning to just terminate employees?
So I would say back in the 80s and 90s, maybe I'm dating myself a little bit. I would say that PIPs were generally used with good intention, maybe half the time, maybe a little bit more. I would honestly say today that I could honestly say that not even 1 in 20 are used correctly. I couldn't even say, I think I've come across like one person I've spoken to out of hundreds that felt that there was a legitimate PIP that was put in place. There's never any training. There's never any, the duration of the PIP is never enough time for you to meet it. So you have a 6 month sales cycle, but you're told that you have to close 5 new logos in the next 30 days. I mean, you know, they're asked to, they're judging you on things that you've never been measured on or paid on before. just to demean you, micromanage you, give you them an excuse to terminate you when you actually meet the criteria that matter. You know, they give you things that will discourage you or distract you from meeting the goal, and, you know, to demean and disrespect you. You know, they gaslight you about why you're on it. So, you know, this happens all the time. PIPs should be illegal. If you actually gave a crap about your employee, you're not going to sit there and threaten their job. Okay, all that's going to do is cause more anxiety and more stress and cause underperformance, not overperformance.
Okay? Yeah, I should clarify the term. If anybody's unfamiliar, PIP stands for Performance Improvement Plan. And it's basically the a legal justification bosses will put out there in order to fire you. You know, if they want to fire you, first they make you sign a document saying like, hey, I'm going to achieve X number of things within the next 30 days. Otherwise, I'm terminated. They'll pressure you to sign that too. Should you sign a PIP if your boss puts
No, I mean, I did a post about this too, a survey. I'm not a fan of signing PIPs. They'll tell you that you're not acknowledging a poor performance. You're just acknowledging that you've received it. You know, unless they're going to literally fire you and walk you out the door, of which they'll threaten that maybe 20% of the time and follow up on it maybe 10% of that 20%. And it may even be illegal to do, to tell you the honest to goodness truth. I'm not a fan of signing PIPs. They're just going to go ahead and put you on that PIP, whether you sign it or not. In very rare instances, very, very rare, have I seen either the threat or the actual following through of a termination for not signing it.
Yeah. Most of the time, it's just they're giving you busy work. that's going
to
like...
No, I mean, it's to demean you so that you'll say, you know what? I'm above this. This entire thing is a lie. My performance is great. The PIP is unachievable. I'm above this. I'm not going to sit around and be disrespected and demeaned. I'm going to go ahead and you'll get another job and be gone. And that's exactly what they want you to do, because now you have saved them significantly on separation costs. What they should be doing instead is coming to you. The right way to fire someone, Chris, is the following. Instead of these false PIPs, okay, go to your employee and say, look, you know that you're an employee at will. We can let you go anytime we want. We truly do care about you, okay? We have the right to let you go. Rather than just randomly terminating you with some false BS about performance, we're going to give you a heads up. You've got 2 months as a full-time employee here to go find your next job. You can choose to continue to work and do your job or not. We're still going to pay you. And then after 2 months, if you found a job, great, go off and do it. And if you haven't, we're going to let you go. We're going to give you 2 to 4 weeks per year that you've worked, with a month of health care for each month. And there's not an employee in the world that would not be an advocate, would not be beholden to the company. It would not think the world of how they were treated on that way out. The amount of money that it costs the employer to do it the right way is minimal. The amount of time that is spent in the organization between human resources, the manager, the employee, micromanaging the PIP, reviewing it, all that BS when you already know what the outcome is going to be. Show them some basic respect and dignity. Do the right thing. Don't gaslight and lie to them about it. There's a right way and a wrong way. And sadly, 95% of all organizations are using PIPs the wrong way today.
Yeah. So I'm just going to reveal something to the audience here. I am an idiot. So I once worked in a job where I was put on a PIP. And I was furious because like 80% of our team had missed quota, including like the top guy on the team. And I was the only one that got the PIP because I was having an issue with management. And I did the stupid thing, which was I beat the PIP. I was on a 30-day PIP and I knew I had some deals coming in. So I said, okay, they put me through. I had to go through all these trainings on time management, which took up hours and hours of my day. And I beat the PIP. I was the top revenue earner in the company for that month. Top of the leaderboard. They came to me and said, congratulations, you beat the PIP. And I quit. I said, thanks a lot. I quit and I left. And that was probably stupid, but it was like a pride thing to me. I was so offended that they put them on the PIP that I wanted them to see that they made a mistake. I wanted them to look at that leaderboard and see that I was at the top of the leaderboard. And that's the note that I wanted to end on.
And Chris, if they put you on a PIP, they wanted to get rid of you in the first place. Yeah. You know, if you hadn't quit, they probably would have fired you within the month. It's just how the game is played. I literally had two DMs this morning that I woke up to. Same exact scenario. Top performer, should never been put on the PIP, beat the crap out of the PIP, and now 4 weeks later, they've now terminated him. Two different DMs today, similar stories. The PIP is a message to you that it should be a paid interview period, not a performance improvement plan. Every single time, take that time and interview. Do the quiet quitting. You know, you got to show up, still go to your meetings, whatever. You know, do what you need to do. But they are sending you a clear message and giving you the time to go and interview for a job. They're just not being transparent and forthcoming with you.
Yeah, I think too I read the question asking like, hey, you know, is the PIP ever used to help people like implant? As someone said, pervasive incompetence protocol. Yeah, you know, it's never a good sign, right? And, you know, I always say if you actually are a manager and somebody is struggling on your team, actually, what you want to do is you kind of want to bring them in close. You know, if you really wanted to help somebody, you would get curious about what they're doing and how you can help them. And I find PIPs actually do the opposite. PIPs are what your boss gives you when they don't want to deal with you anymore. They're not curious about what you're going through. They don't see it as their responsibility to help you get better. So now they've got a piece of paper saying, hey, you're going to do X and Y and Z, or we're going to push you out the door. It's creating distance between you and your employee.
Why is there no accountability for the manager, for the performance of the employee? Why is the manager not on a dual PIP at the same time? And that they resolve it together. And if the manager can't get his employee to perform, why isn't he walked out the door? Why is it such a one-way street all the time? They use it to deflect their own poor performance and throw their underlings under the bus to kick the can down the road and save their ass a little longer. It happens all the time. It's just, you can probably tell I'm a little bit passionate about this. It annoys me to no end. The gamesmanship, the BS that's played. I mean, just treat people real. Treat them. Can't we go back to kindergarten, right? Be nice to people. Treat them the way you want to be treated. I mean, it's that simple. It's just shocking to me that this is allowed to go on at the highest levels. What's even more, when you mentioned earlier about the trolls coming in, about, you know, you whiners and all that. You know who the only trolls that I ever get are people who are lawyers, people who are in HR, or old timers who are so disconnected from this that they can't believe any of it has ever happened.
Yeah. And you know what? If they get screwed over, they're not going to take it quietly. When it's them that get screwed over, like all of a sudden it becomes very important. And like, yeah, I guess that's why we're having this conversation today, because you're either a person who's been through something like this, or oftentimes you're a person who's like, well, that could never happen to me because I'm responsible. I work hard. I, you know, show up and do all the right things. And like, that's the one lesson I think we're really trying to drive home today is, if you wait until you're thrown in that emergency Zoom meeting to start evaluating your options, your emotions are going to take over. That sense of panic that you get, that need to impress your bosses, somebody puts something in front of you and says, sign this right now. If you're not the type of person who's used to rocking the boat, you know, you might get pushed into making decisions that aren't going to help you, you know?
Dude, that's literally my mission, honestly. My mission is to encourage other people to stand up and question and rock the boat. That they have been brainwashed throughout their lives to just blindly trust, not rock the boat, not be confrontational, you know, especially women. You know, I mean, I hear it all the time. And if you look at things in that lens, you will be a victim. Society will take advantage of you. They have for generations. It's time for us all to stand up and put an end to it.
Yeah. And there is a positive story on positive ending on the story of my PIP. So one, I finally decided to go like my own way. I started my own business. I'm much happier now. But two, it's funny because I left at a period of time where a couple other employees left at the same time. And the bosses got scared. And a couple of days later, I got a text from a former coworker saying, hey, I don't know if I want to tell you this, but thanks a lot. They just increased all of our compensation packages. They went through, they looked around and saw people high up on the leaderboard picking up and going to greener pastures, and they decided to change. People standing up for themselves actually spurred leadership to create more generous compensation programs.
Let me give you a story, an add-on story to that. So there was a company out there that terminated somebody. It became public. And they had been mistreating employees for a long time. They had been terminating people unjustly, offering no severance, and then contesting unemployment. So this became a public matter. The company stepped up and did the right thing. And they realized, you know, the bad look that it showed upon them. So you know what happened? They proactively reached out to a dozen employees that they had wrongfully terminated and blocked unemployment and offered them 6 to 12 weeks severance and told them to go refile for unemployment. I literally got DMs from people that I had never heard of or thought of or knew who reached out and said, you don't know me. You may not know this has happened, but I now just got 6 to 10 weeks severance and I can pay my rent for the next 3 months.
Yeah. Yeah. That is, I've seen it. I've actually seen these companies on LinkedIn, in part because of the role Dan plays here. They have to eat crow and they have to go and they finally stop fighting the employees and provide some severance and some
money. Do the right thing.
Yeah. And again, if you're facing down a medical bill, if you're facing down a mortgage, if you are suffering with rent, these things can make a huge difference in your life, but closed mouths don't get fed. And the only way you're going to get what's right is if you reach out and you actually speak up. So
let me add another point here, Chris.
Yeah.
The other thing I want to say is that the reason why employers are able to take advantage of employees so frequently is that they know the game and they're running the game on you. And you don't even know the game is being run on you. Okay. This is a very anxiety provoking situation. You're being wrongly terminated. You're being gaslit. You're being blindsided by it. You don't know when you're going to get a job next. Your head is spinning and they literally count on that. They take advantage of that. They prey on that. Okay. So you need to make sure that you are taking a step back, taking a deep breath, not having a knee jerk reaction in an emotional way to what's just happened. They want you to do that. Okay. So just realize what's going on. They've done this hundreds of times. You're experiencing it for the first time and set yourself up for success. Do not play into their game. Step back and realize what's actually going on, what's driving the situation, and take action to protect yourself.
Yes. Well, Dan, I could sit here and talk with you about this all the live long day, but unfortunately, we have reached the end of today's episode. So I'm going to give one more time. If anybody is watching this live or anybody's listening to the audio version of this episode, if you're watching this live, go ahead, scan the QR code. If you want to follow Dan on LinkedIn, I strongly recommend it. He is giving fantastic advice away every day for how you can protect yourself, whether you're getting hired or fired. Dan, if people who are listening to this episode want to get in contact with you, what's the best way for them to do that?
Yeah, I mean, you can reach out via email, dan@dangoodmaneea.com. You can connect with me on LinkedIn. We're going to have a webpage launching any day now, www.dangoodmaneea.com. Reach out. I am very approachable. I return all inquiries. We've got a team of folks that we're working with right now that are helping me. We've got 4 employees right now that are working behind the scenes on this. And we are very excited to bring employee advocacy to employees everywhere, to empower them to stand up and to feel good about their situations and not have years of regret how they were treated.
Excellent. Yes, definitely get in touch with Dan. He's a great guy. Even if you're not in some sort of precarious situation with your job, he's a fun guy. He's a nice guy. I'm very glad that I'm connected to him. So connect with Dan. Also, big thank you for today's sponsor, Flying Cat. So Flying Cat, premier SEO and content creation agency. Do not do this by yourself, especially if you are looking to expand your B2B SaaS company into Europe. They are cool. They are fun. They are going to create natural, organic marketing and sales materials for you so you can make sure that you are expanding your business and you are growing. If you want to meet with Flying Cat, go ahead and scan the QR code that you are seeing on your screen right now. And of course, if you want to get in touch with me, you can find me. I'm Chris Bogue on LinkedIn. Go ahead, ring my bell, send me a DM. I connect with everybody who reaches out to me. I love to chat. I'm a social butterfly. I'm always down to chat about video, comedy, LinkedIn, you name it. And I do have a digital course. So the complete guide to selling on video is available for sale at chrisbogue.io. You can scan the QR code on screen if you want to get started. It is 2.5 hours of original content. If you see the types of comedy sketches I'm doing, that's what the course is like. So we go in depth. I show, I don't tell. I do everything to help you build your first video-based sales process. So every stage of the pipeline, from cold outreach to mid-pipeline to follow-ups and referrals, it's all in there. There's comedy sketches. We go through thumbnailing, subtitles, LinkedIn, Gmail, you name it. Check out the complete guide to selling on video at chrisbogue.io. And that's it. So thank you very much, everybody. Dan, say bye.
Bye, everybody. It's been a great hour.